This is the extraordinary true story of this young Irish boy's journey through life in one of the bloodiest times in human history. Little did he know then how this journey would end. Revolutionary blood flowed through his veins. His great-grandfather, Matthew Keogh, fought the British in the rebellion of 1798. His granduncle, Miles Keogh, fought at Gettysburg and ended up dying at the Little Bighorn. His grandparents, Michael and Margaret, and their children were evicted from their home and land in Glenogue, Coolagreny, County Wexford, by the British on Anglo-Irish. Grandfather Michael became a leader in the Coolagreny land struggle. With no land, most of the Keoghs emigrated to the United States of America. Young Michael's father, Lawrence, stayed on and moved to Tullamore, County Offaly, and then on to Tullow, County Carlow. By age 16, Michael was a Gaelic scholar and champion Irish dancer when he emigrated to New York in 1906. He joined the Clan na Gael and the Irish Republican Brotherhood before joining the 69th Regiment of the United States Army. In 1911, he was shot in the abdomen at the Mexican border. He returned to Ireland in 1913 and joined the Royal Irish Regiment of the British Army as an Irish Republican Brotherhood infiltrator. But on the outbreak of World War I, he was shipped out with the British Expeditionary Forces. He fought and was eventually captured in the Battle of Mons in August 1914. He was a POW along with other Irish, English and Scottish soldiers at Sinnelager Camp in Germany. And in December 1914, he was transferred with 1,500 Irish soldiers to Limburg Camp. While at Limburg, he met Roger Casement for the second time. Casement had signed a treaty with the Germans for arms and aid for the forthcoming Irish Rebellion. He was also recruiting Irish volunteers from the POW camp at Limburg to join in the fight for Irish freedom.
That when I was a boy, we were slave-minded, serfs. And anyone that come along and lift us out of that position, I looked upon with God.
Keogh and only 55 others out of 1,500 Irishmen volunteered. 1,400 decided to stay loyal to their British masters. Some believed Britain would grant Ireland home rule after the war. Of course, it was another lie. Irishmen would have to fight and die to gain their freedom from the British Empire. Casement returned to Ireland, but was captured and eventually hanged by the British. The ship carrying the arms was tracked down by a British cruiser, and the German captain Carl Spindler scuttled the ship. After 1 week of fighting, the 1916 riot was over, and the leaders executed. The Irish Brigade were stranded in Germany. They had been trained as machine gun corps, and after 1 year in Danzig, Keogh and other Irishmen joined the 14th Bavarian Regiment of the German Army. Their thinking, if they could not fight the British at home, they would fight them on the western fronts of Europe. Britain's troubles would be Ireland's opportunity to fight for freedom. In his memoirs, however, Keogh does not gloss over or glamorize the horrors of warfare. In one of his paragraphs he says, and I quote, "I took part in the big German offensive on the Western Front from May to August 1918 with my Bavarian Infantry Regiment. In August Some of that time I had spent with gallant Bavarian comrades in the front line trenches, when modern warfare had become hell on earth, with practically 36 nations of the white, black, red and yellow races taking part, I was not satisfied till the opportunity given me was fulfilled. At times, however, I had to shut off the feed of my machine gun owing to the sickening horror of the process, shooting off at the rate of a half thousand a minute and mowing down a retreating enemy like locusts before a hurricane on the African veld. In 1918, he met a Bavarian Red Cross nurse named Anna Maria Seifert while being treated for a shrapnel wound to the neck. They later married in Nuremberg, Bavaria, and remained together the rest of their lives.
Unsere beiden Schatten sahen wie ein Haus, das wir lieb uns hatten, das sah man gleich daran. Und alle Leute sollen es sehen, wenn wir bei der Laterne stehen, wie einst Lili Marleen, wie einst Lili.
In September 1918, Michael Kehoe was at a field dressing post near Ligny on the French border when he says he seen Gefreiter Adolf Hitler on a stretcher. He says Hitler had a slight wound to the head and badly wounded to the groin. says the medics were convinced Hitler would die from his wounds. This was a contradiction to Hitler's claims that he was gassed. A few days later, Michael Kehoe went down with trench fever, the black flu of 1918, and finished out the war in hospital. He says the fever killed many men. First World War finally ended on the 11th of November 1918. Revolution was well underway in Germany, and in May of 1919, when the Bolsheviks had control of Munich, Michael Kehoe was a captain, Hauptmann, of a machine gun company when the stormtroopers launched an attack on the communists. Three other Irishmen were in the stormtroopers: Jeremiah O'Callaghan, Patrick McDonough, and Patrick Sweeney. During the battle to oust the communists, Patrick Sweeney was killed. A number of weeks later, Michael Kehoe was officer in charge of the guard at the Turkenstrasse barracks in Munich when he arrested Adolf Hitler. Hitler and another man by the name of Zimmermann were preaching to 200 Trollian troops in the gymnasium when the troops took offence to their preachings. They dragged Hitler and Zimmermann from the tabletop and beat them up. Michael Kehoe ordered the guard to fire a volley of shots into the ceiling and dragged Hitler and Zimmermann out and arrested them. They were brought to the guard room and the medics were called to attend their wounds. Keogh says the next time he saw Hitler was in August of 1930 in Nuremberg. Hitler was preaching from a massive platform to thousands of people. Michael Kehoe and the other Irishmen were discharged from the German army in September 1919, but their troubles did not end there. By then, the Irish War of Independence had already started in January of 1919. Kehoe and other Irishmen in Germany made their way to Ireland to aid their countrymen in their struggle for freedom. Three of Michael Kehoe's comrades from Germany died in that struggle. They were Sergeant Timothy Quinlist, James McCarthy, and Jeremiah O'Callaghan. Timothy H. Quinlis was later suspected of informing to the British on the whereabouts of Michael Collins and subsequently executed by the IRA.
As British soldiers policed the streets, the Irish Republican Army, the IRA, was being organised in secret. Its strategy was to render the country ungovernable by demoralising the army and the police and paralysing the civil administration. The only tactic left the professional army was guerrilla war.
During the war, owing to contacts in Germany, Keogh travelled back and forth in the coal bunker of ships to help in arms smuggling. One of the contacts was Sean Cavanagh, former Casement Brigade member and now a Hamburg dock police officer. He used the name Jack Newman while in Germany. Like most of Casement's brigade, they had to change their names in case they were caught by the British. Keogh had the alias names of George Keogh, Chris Cunick and Kurt Swartz. With the war escalating, Britain began recruiting more men, some were returning World War I veterans. The new recruits became known as the Black and Tans, and along with the British auxiliaries, they soon had a reputation for their ruthlessness and brutality. So the Irish rebels became just as ruthless as their enemy. The rebels were outnumbered 13-1, and the Irish Republican forces took guerrilla warfare to a new level.
Once upon a time there was Irish ways and Irish laws, villages of Irish blood, waking to the morning, waking to the morning.
It became commonplace. The Black and Tans began to take reprisals on those they suspected of harbouring the rebels. Creameries, so crucial to Ireland's dairy economy, were wrecked, like this one at Mallow. Houses were sacked and burnt. Suspects were shot. These reprisals convinced the Irish that Britain was unfit to administer Ireland and led them to support the IRA. Black and Tans are remembered and hated to this day.
They just ran through every town and village, guns at the ready.
But they could not make us turn. We are a river flowing. We're a river flowing. Again the soldiers came, burned our houses, stole our grain, shot the farmers in their fields, working for a living, working for a living. Today the struggle carries on. I wonder, will I live so long?
In one incident in 1920, Michael Kehoe, along with three others from the Midland Brigade of the IRA, were sent to assist the training of volunteers on the Kilkenny side of Mount Leinster. They were travelling on bicycles. By the time they got there, the Black and Tans and auxiliaries had already engaged the trainees on the side of the mountain. In the gun battle, the four from the Midland Brigade opened fire on the flank of the attacking British forces, slowing them down enough to enable the trainee volunteers to escape over the mountain. Keogh and the Midlanders escaped the way they arrived, down the mountain on their bicycles, to live and fight another day.
Above the pain descending, once upon a time there was Irish ways and Irish laws. of Irish blood, waking to the morning.
Evens of you, even the swan sings with clear eyes to the beating of his wings. Evens of you, even the swan sings with clear eyes to the beating of his wings.
After joining the Irish Army, Michael Kehoe, who was an engineer by trade, was attached to the engineering corps. He recalls in his memoirs referring to the civil wars in Germany 1918 and 1919 and in Ireland from 1922 to 1923. Quote, I had a taste of internecine strife also in Germany in late 1918 and 1919, when it was my ill luck to witness human beings being made to dig their own graves and to be then shot into them. I feel the one consolation that it was my luck not to be called on to stain my rifle against my fellow countrymen in 1922-1923. In order to justify the hanging in 1916 of a knight of the realm, Roger Casement's name was blackened by the powerful British forgery and propaganda machine. So much so that successive Irish governments shied away from honouring the Irish martyr, patriot and champion of human rights throughout the world till 50 years after his death. During all that time and up to their own deaths, Keogh and his comrades defended their noble chief's honour at every opportunity. Casement's volunteers never received recognition for their loyalty or sacrifices for their motherland, even though some of them died doing so, from any Irish government while the survivors were alive or even to this day. Keogh's sardonic humour to this neglect was that Irish government ministers and their top civil servants were too preoccupied stepping into the shoes and houses of their former British masters. And I leave the last words to Michael Kehoe. Quote, machine guns, disguises, knives, mortar and bicycles. It's been a mixed up life, but my last war is done. I have outlived almost all the men I fought. I have no enemies. I am at peace. Tiel, Machine Gewehre, Verkleidungen, Messer, Mord und Fahrräder, Fahre eine Gemuster auf Liebens. Aber meine letzte Krieg getan wird. Ich habe fast alle Männer, die ich die Kämpfe überlebt. Ich habe keine Feinde, ich bin im Frieden.